Mr. Tharoor has now grabbed a mic, so maybe we can get his reactions on today's budget.
I haven't been following the market, but the fiscal deficit figure she announced at the very end of her speech, by the way, is exactly the same figure they announced last year and failed to meet.
Yeah.
They said 3.3, they've now said 3.4,
and then hiked it to 3.4 and back there.
I must say there has always been a big gap between aspiration and reality with this government. For the last 5 years, we've been seeing projections of revenue that were never met in the actual revenues collected. We've been seeing projections of GDP growth that clearly have not been met. It was very interesting that in her speech she completely avoided the entire issue of GDP growth and macroeconomic picture. It was all very much more about the kinds of messages that the Prime Minister wished to deliver to his electorate. And I must say that some omissions truly startled us, such as the interim budget made such a noise about Ayushman Bharat, it wasn't even mentioned now. Health has been completely ignored.
Yes, you do have details on that, Mr. Tharoor, and the spend is up almost 1.5 times. So there is a lot more that is being spent on Ayushman.
Okay, but odd that it wasn't
those
mentioned.
Those details weren't mentioned.
No. Yeah.
So can I just ask you, you know, all these schemes that were announced, it's not that the Congress party didn't have schemes, you did announce a lot of them, but some of them, Swachh Bharat, for example, and others, seem to have made a major impact in the elections. I remember speaking to you just before the elections and you were rather optimistic on the way things could go. The way it turned out, when you analyze it, it may well be because of some of the schemes that were done. Some of what she spoke about today, if it comes to PAN, could also have a major impact.
Housing,
Jal, water for all, some of this stuff is potentially steps that could have a major impact on the ground.
Well, I think for the country's sake, we hope that we all have water for all and housing. But look at the fine print again, even from her own speech. Housing, she's also mentioned rather heavy taxes and import duties on pretty much everything that goes into a house, from flooring to tiles to roofs to fixtures and fittings, even furniture mountings. Now, of course, these are import taxes, so presumably it will encourage Indian manufacturers. But the reason that so many real estate companies were indeed importing from abroad, mainly China, is because they were so much cheaper. So costs will go up. Is that going to make for a boom in the real estate industry? I have some hesitations. But we'll see if a lot of money comes into these rights, and maybe it will, but all depends on the actual numbers from the point of view of the individual buyer. Similarly, let's look at the reality of Swachh Bharat, right? According to independent objective study, 65% of the toilets installed so far have no running water. So there is a sense in the election that people said, Sarkar ne kuch na kuch to kiya. But the fact is how usable those toilets are and to what degree they will completely eliminate the problem of open defecation remains to be seen. The gas cylinder, same story. The stories we're getting from reporters around the world, around the country, is that something like 90% of these gas cylinders, the recipients are unable to afford a refill. Or very few refills, say one every year rather than the four they're supposed to have to be able to make it last. So there has always been a wonderful aspirational quality to the government's objectives, and they've certainly been rewarded by the electorate for having shown some willingness to start implementing them. But to the extent that you want them to have an impact on the daily lives of the Aam Aadmi, of ordinary Indians, they're still, I'm afraid, as they would say, the jury is out on this, because
theoretically you'll say to the jury is that they just won a massive election with 300 seats, so obviously the people seem to believe that those schemes work.
Yes, they work, but within the limitations I mentioned to you according to these studies. The latest thing we've got from this budget is the petrol and the cess and the tax, which will be 2 rupees extra on every litre of petrol and diesel. That's an alarming 2 rupees, because she mentioned one of cess and one of tax. Now the fact is that is going to have an impact on very ordinary people. It doesn't only affect the people with the Mercedes.
Okay.
Because the ordinary person's shirt and chappal are going to cost a lot more because the manufacturer has to transport it to a market using petrol or diesel. All of these things are going to have an impact on ordinary people, and that's who we are concerned about.
Is there a specific bone of contention that you intend to raise around the budget from the Congress party's perspective, something that you took umbrage to in specific? Is there any one topic over there that you're not
I have to look at the numbers in greater detail, but amongst the points I mentioned to you, I certainly intend to raise them in the budget debate.
All right, one last question. The Congress party has spoken, the BJP used to talk about that when the Congress was in power, tax terrorism, the problems with compliance. You said it in your manifesto, we have to do something about it. At least some of steps were taken or were announced today to try and make it easier to comply and to reduce that interface with the tax department. Were you satisfied with that?
Well, I think we'll have to see if businesses are satisfied with it, because the real challenge the government faces is that they have these unrealistic revenue projections. To raise the revenue, they put heavy pressure on their tax officials to go out and inspect and raid and check books and so on. Tax terrorism comes from pressure on the tax official to show results to the government. On top of that, of course, you've got the underlying issues of corruption and so on, which we'll put aside for the moment. Many business people I spoke to, and even after the election, are saying that they're extremely reluctant to invest in India because of their concerns about the way in which the tax system works. Now, if these gestures that have been announced will actually have a beneficial effect, then we'll see it. You know, it's very striking that private investment is down 87% from the same quarter last year, and what is worse, 81% from just last quarter. So there is a tremendous amount of hesitation on the part of Indian businesses to invest in India. And that has to do a lot with the way in which the government's tax system works. So let's hope you're right. But I will leave my skepticism intact until we see results that we can actually look at and measure on the ground.